Hello and welcome to the Scott Arboretum. My name is Adam Glas. We are here in the cherry border today. And as you can see, we are gonna plant a ball and burlap tree, or commonly known as a B&B tree. So we're adding a cherry here to the cherry border. We are going to go through the process of planting this today. One thing to note with ball and burlap trees, because of the way that they're grown, a lot of times in the nursery rows, in order to keep weeds and things at bay, they do mechanical tilling around the trees in between the rows. And a lot of times what happens is that the soil gets piled up on top of the root system of the tree, as well as the trunk. And it kind of buries the root flare. And I'll explain more about what the root flare is when we get the tree in the hole. But the first step is we kind of do some measurements. We don't want to be digging a hole larger than we have to, so we take some rough measurements. And generally speaking, you want to dig, I would say the hole about 6 to 8 inches bigger than the root ball itself. The reason for that is so that we've got enough room to get water and soil back around the root system once the tree gets in the hole. One of the main components of tree success is having good root soil contact. So once you get that tree back in the hole and start backfilling with the soil, you really want to make sure you've got enough space to get water and soil around those so those roots aren't exposed to air and then they die out because of the exposure to air and drying. So yeah, usually I just use my shovel as kind of a rough estimate, measure the ball, and then our nice little green flag here is where the tree's going. So then I just kind of roughly make some marks. And you can see this is totally an exact science. And then we just start digging. So just trying to make a nice round tree ring here. So if you really wanted to be fancy, you could do a string line to make a nice round circle and use some spray paint in order to make your circle nice and round. So the next crucial step in planting this tree is to measure the root ball. So we really want to keep this root ball intact as much as possible so that, again, that we're not exposing those roots to air. We may not be successful with this one because it's pretty loose. So if you're shopping for trees and you're looking at ball and burlap trees, you want to try and find a ball and burlap tree that the root ball feels really solid. You know, you might want to move it around a little bit and see if it stays intact. This one, the soil looks like it's pretty wet and pretty sandy. So when we move it, it kind of wiggles a little bit. So I'm kind of guessing that it might fall apart on us a little bit. But the next main step is to measure the root ball. So with keeping that in mind, keeping the root ball intact, we really don't want to be planting this tree too deep. We really want the bottom of this root ball to sit on undisturbed soil. So measurement is important so that you're not digging too deep, and over time as the tree settles and that soil underneath that has been disturbed settles, the tree will settle as well. So we really want that root flare, which we'll talk about a little bit more in a minute, to be slightly above or just at the level of your native soil here, the topography of the soil. We're at a little bit of a slope, so we'll have to do a little extra care and little measurement on that so that, you know, we're keeping that root ball above the soil line. So I'm gonna just do, again, some rough measurements here with my shovel just to kind of see how deep we need to dig this hole. So, you know, it's about, I'd say about 14 inches deep currently. But likely we will have to pull some of this soil off the top of the root ball to expose the root flare. So we're actually going to err on the side of caution. We'll probably dig the hole about 12 inches deep. It's always better to plant your trees a little bit high than too deep. So we've got the hole dug primarily, and then we're just going to do a second measurement to make sure we're accurate. So if you don't have a measuring tape on hand, another way that you can easily do that again is with just the handle of your shovel or your tool. First we lay another tool across the hole, so that kind of gives you a rough idea of the top of the soil level. And then again, you measure your, roughly measure your root ball. And place that handle in the bottom of the hole and reference it to the handle of the other shovel. So you can see where my hand is a little bit higher than the soil level. And that's in anticipation of having to probably remove some of the soil off the top of that root ball. So it is a little bit high, but again, it's better if it's planted a little bit high than too low. So when you're shopping for ball and burlap trees, they come in two different sort of enclosures. So quite typically, and probably more often than not, there will be a wire cage around the root ball. And generally when we plant with wire cages, it will also have ropes and twine along the top like this one does. But as you can see, this one does not have a wire cage, it's all twine. So in this instance, we generally put the tree in whole first. You know, all the enclosures or containment devices on it, leave it on there just to try and keep the root ball intact as much as possible. If it comes with a wire cage, we generally leave the wire cage on in the hole for the most part, but a lot of times we'll cut the bottom off and we'll leave the sides intact, and then we'll take the twine off the top. So it'll still hold together, but we want to remove everything off of the trees once we get them in the hole. So by cutting the wire cage off the bottom and removing the twine off the top, we can still remove that cage once it's in the hole. But because we don't have that option with this one, because it does not have the wire cage, we find it's better to move it in the hole intact, so that as you're rolling it, the root ball is not falling apart. So with this type, the next step is to just remove all this twine and remove all the burlap. And there's really no specific technique to do this. You just keep cutting until it's all loose and free. And again, we really like to remove everything off the root ball, whether it's in a wire cage or in twine, just because we don't want to inhibit any of that root growth from having to grow into the native soil surrounding it. You know, burlap and twine will biodegrade over time, but again, we just don't want any impediment of those roots growing into the soil at any time. And another thing about burlap is once it's dry, it actually becomes hydrophobic, so it repels water. So if you leave this burlap on here and this little collar that sits above the soil level is exposed to air, it will dry out, and a lot of the other burlap will dry out as well, so that when it gets completely dry, like I said, it's hydrophobic, it has a hard time reabsorbing water. So it, you know, will really dry the top of the root ball out, which is really detrimental to the root system of the tree. So another tip that we do here is before we get the tree completely planted, we generally take the tie, the twine off of the top. It's just another little tip to save some time. You know, if you get the tree planted and you forget to untie it, then you got to get a ladder and climb back up there. So by cutting it off when it's down, it just saves a little bit of time. So I keep mentioning root flare and that we don't want the root flare to be too deep. So the root flare is where the tree's roots naturally meet the base of the trunk. So this is a cherry, and cherries are often grafted, and that's what you see going on here, kind of this interesting looking structure here. So the root flare, like I said, is where the roots naturally meet the trunk of the tree. And the reason we don't want that buried is because that's what really provides the structure of the tree. If you think of it as kind of like buttresses for the tree, they go out from the tree like this and they really give the tree lots of stability and strength with wind and, you know, heavy snow loads or anything of that sort. So if you bury that too deep, it compromises the structure of the tree and the strength of the tree. And the main reason it does that is because the roots of the tree want to be within the top 12 to 18 inches of the soil. And if you bury those roots too deep initially, they're actually going to kind of grow up like this. So it creates kind of a point where your tree can tip a little bit at the base, and it just weakens the tree in terms of being able to withstand load, whether it be wind or snow or any of those things. Yeah, what we really need to do now is remove a lot of this top soil here so that we can expose the root flare. And you know, whether you get a containerized tree or a ball and burlap tree, a lot of times the root flare is buried too deep in whatever container, type of container it comes in. So you can see I'm removing several inches of soil here. So when we dug the hole, we accounted for that. You know, and on a slope like this, you know, slight slope like this, you will generally have the low side of your ball a little bit higher than the top side to account for the grade change so that your root flare is above the ground. So I'll mention again that it's really important that you get the soil settled around that root ball. And the best way that we find to do it is to backfill a little bit around the root ball, and then we water it thoroughly and let that settle in. And then we're going to repeat that process one or two times, just depending on how well we feel that soil is settling in around the root ball. So you never really want to pack the soil in around the tree. We don't want to increase any density of the soil. We want to still have nice porosity in the soil. We don't want to compact the soil at all. So, you know, we may do a light settling in of the soil with our hands, but you'll never see us tamping away at with a shovel or our foot or anything to settle the soil in. But you can see I'm using lots of water. And generally what I'll do is keep adding water until it gets to a point where it's pretty much saturated and the water isn't draining away. Just trying to get that soil to settle in and fill in any of those air pockets that are in and around there. You may also notice that we're not adding any compost. We're not adding any fertilizer. So we want the trees to get used to the native soil that they're growing in as quickly as possible. So we generally don't add any fertilizer or compost when we're planting trees like this. Some people believe that by adding compost and fertilizer to the media around the root ball, that the roots don't want to grow out into the native soil because you've created a really nice, beautiful environment. So they'd rather stay into that nice little pocket than grow out into the surrounding soil. So another thing I forgot to mention a little bit earlier is that sometimes when you're digging the hole for your tree, especially if you have heavy clay soils, the smooth back part of your shovel can actually cause what is commonly referred to as glazing of the soil. So you can kind of see it happening here a little bit, and I can kind of demonstrate. So if you push your shovel straight down, see how it creates a really nice smooth surface? Well, some people believe that that creates a seal, so that water can't penetrate through that seal. So it just kind of creates a little bit of a bathtub where water sits in there and the roots are basically sitting in water, which is not great because we all know that roots need oxygen to survive. So to minimize that glazing, a lot of times what we'll do is just kind of chop up the edges of the hole to break that up a little bit. So the next step is to keep backfilling. So we're going to backfill again, add a little bit more water, and we may repeat that process two or three times until we get up to the native soil level here. So we've got all our backfilling in. It's looking good. It's at a good level. We did another thorough watering, so we're just letting the water settle in a little bit. And then you can see next to me, we've got this nice mulch that we produce here on campus. It's a 50-50 blend of composted wood chips and composted leaves. So we're going to spread about 4 or 5 inches of that around the tree just to help with soil temperature and soil moisture and keep weeds down as well. So we want to preserve as much of the soil moisture in here as possible. So by adding this nice mulch, we can help with that as well and weed suppression. So yeah, we're going to do that. So we've added a nice layer of mulch, like I said earlier. And with the mulch, we really want to keep it away from that root flare. So again, we don't want any material piling up against the trunk of the tree here, adding moisture to the bark. You know, it's kind of like moisture against our skin. If our skin is wet all the time, it gets kind of pruney, which weakens the bark, which could create issues with fungus or insect issues. So we really want to keep the bark dry. So you can see, instead of doing mulch volcanoes, which I'm sure we've seen around, what we try to promote is mulch donuts. So leaving about 3 to 6 inches away from the trunk of the tree, 3 to 6 inches of nice mulch around the root ball, and about 3 feet away from the trunk. So that's our general recommendations for when you're planting a new tree. Another thing to kind of do when you've planted a large tree like this that's been tied up for quite a while. This one bounced open pretty quickly, but sometimes if you just kind of take the branches and tease them out a little bit, it just helps them get back to their new form. Thing in terms of aftercare for watering, we say if you don't get an inch of rain from the sky in a week, you're going to want to get out there and give it a good drink of water once a week for the first year of its life. So here we are in mid-April, so we'll be watering this tree until mid-April of next year. Again, no fertilizer or anything like that. We just let the trees grow naturally on their own. So then the last step of the process is to put a stake in. And again, like I mentioned earlier, for us, the staking is more of a vandalism deterrent, but in the case of a large B&B tree like this, that's got a pretty good size canopy, if a wind whips through here, it can take the tree and tip it over before the root system establishes. So generally speaking, we do one angle stake kind of against the prevailing winds, and you definitely want the stake to go into the native soil. It's the most stable and you won't compromise any of the roots that are in the root ball. So we've got our stake pounded in, it's nice and secure, and then we've got these really nice tree straps here, and you can see on the underside, this is the side you want to put against the trunk. It's got grooves in it, so any rain or snow can melt and run through, so it's not really holding any moisture against the trunk. Generally what we do is we just do a little loop around the trunk at the appropriate height, and then a loop around the stake and close it off, and you're good to go. So it does allow the tree to move a little bit, so helps with those stabilizing roots to get established a little bit more quickly. And this is a rubber strap, so as the trunk begins to grow, it will expand with the growth of the trunk. And then generally speaking, we usually leave these on for about a year. So give the tree a good year to get some roots established. You know, and a great way to test it is if you take the strap off and you kind of wiggle the tree a little bit, if it feels nice and firm, then generally it's safe to take it off. So yeah, that's how we plant ball and burlap trees here at the Scott Arboretum.